It's a cool emblem.
Alright. So behind me here, this metal unit is huge, even if you have all these different pieces of equipment, all these different tanks, are what make up what we call our brew house. Every brewery has a brew house. Besides like our Octo Tiger, everything you see in here, all the equipment and machinery is pretty status quo for any brewery. The only thing that changes is like the size, the shape, and the layout. You can't really reinvent the wheel of the brewery, so our stuff is fairly standard. So all that grain gets transported over here. You can kind of see in the back where the blue piping ends. And the first vessel that is going to get dropped into is what we call our mash mixer, number one. They're all right here. The mash is number one, so it's in the back. Over around the corner here, you'll see on my little board, but we have two water tanks, hot and cold water. We need both at different points in the process. We always have both on hand at all times. So we take hot water, we drop it into the mash mixer with all that grain. And there's a big helicopter, like family at the bottom, just churning up all that grain, all that hot water, getting the grain as wet as possible. That's because hot water is all that you need. What happens when the hot water gets inside those little barley seeds and exposes itself to that starch? That's what breaks down those big starch tubes into smaller sugar molecules. Kind of like when you add sugar to hot tea or hot coffee and you stir it, it dissolves, it's breaking down into a smaller particle. So it's also, it's like basic chemistry, polysaccharide, for any of the monosaccharide, and all that helps you. Someday I'm like, okay, some of it, yeah. Not yet. So we break down as much of those big starches into little sugars, that way it's small enough to feed yeast later on. We transfer that liquid with all that sugar, all the grain, over to the louder tun, which is all the way at the end. So it's that big tank that you guys are standing in front of, right around the corner. About 4 inches up from the very bottom of the louder tun is what's called a false bottom. That false bottom covers the whole thing. It's a giant screen, essentially, with all these little holes in it. And it operates kind of like a sieve or a colander that you use in your kitchen. Those little holes will allow all that hot water and that sugar that we want to turn into beer later on to pass through. But they're small enough, those holes, to catch the solids of the grains that we don't want anymore. That's how we separate out that grain that we eventually send in that silo that we saw outside before it goes to the cows. So all that grain is sitting on the top of the screen as the water and the sugar passes through. And then there's these big rotating rakes inside. They look just like that. They're like big metal zigzags. They rotate on top of that head of grain. As we continue to rinse more hot water through, that process is called sparging. We're trying to rinse out as much of the sugar from the barley as possible. Because like I said, we make high alcohol beers here. So the more sugar we get from every little piece of barley, the more cost effective our process is, the less barley you have to use, the faster the filtration system is, the louder, things like that. So we rinse through all that hot sugar and all that liquid water that combined together. And that's what we're going to turn into beer. It's called Wort, kind of a shirt, spelled W-O-R-T. I saw people on my tour, it's kind of interesting, like, if you really want to break it down. Brewers don't make beer, brewers make Wort, and the yeast makes beer, so we wouldn't be here if the yeast were for them. You can drink like a really great non-alcoholic thing. So we transfer that Wort into one of our two boil kettles. We have two boil kettles. We can have multiple processes going at the same time. In these boil kettles is a big heater. It's the Wort going to even rolling boil for about an hour and a half. In that 90 minutes, we're going to sterilize the Wort, kill off any bacteria that might be in there, and we don't want competing with the yeast later on. And secondly, and probably the more interestingly, that's what we're going to add a bunch of hops. So let's talk about hops for a second. We add hops in the boil. They're like the spice for beer. They balance out all that sugar that's in there to give our beer all kinds of different flavors, bitterness, aromas. That's what hops add. So normally we have like a little cone on the table. Let me check my secret. All right, so this is what a little hop cone looks like in nature. It's not real, but it looks like this. Hops are a cone that grow on a plant known as a vine. Or sorry, vine. Hops are vines. They're similar to vines. contains essential oils and resin. Those oils and resins are what give beer bitterness, our flavor, and our aroma. Hops grow native a lot of places in the world. Once they find a region, they have a climate they like, they can grow very aggressively. And so here in the U.S., most of our hops are grown in the Pacific Northwest, Washington, Oregon, a little bit in Northern California, and Idaho. The U.S. actually recently became the top producing hop country in the world. And that's because of the craft beer industry, I imagine. Hops have been used a lot longer for beer, actually, by humans for medicinal purposes. So before they were used for beer, humans used them to treat things like nausea, insomnia. That's because they are the closest plant in the cannabis family to that plant, so they are cousins to cannabis. So they can treat those similar ailments. And hops, depending on where you get them, they do have different properties, just like varietals for like wine grapes. These are pelletized hops. Most of the hops we use here at Green Flash have been through a process called pelletizing. And what they do is they take the cone off the plant, they crush it, they pound it into these little pellets once it's dried out. And these are just more concentrated. They're cleaner, they're easier, you get all the same things for the most part. And so all our pelletized, or all our hops have been pelletized. These are Citra hops, which are really like nice mellow hop from here in the U.S. Definitely like a little bit of fruity kind of smell. U.S. hops are typically more bitter, piney, sometimes fruity. You go to England, Germany, the Western European hops are more earthy, grassy in flavor. The Czech Republic is a big hop country. They put the hops that are more spicy and zesty. We go to Australia, New Zealand. Right now, their hops are extremely popular with brewers. They're more tropical and more fruity. So it's up to our brewers to figure out not only what hops they want to use and how much they want to add, but when you're going to add them during the boil. Because when you add your hops, you get different things out of them. Maybe you have your home brew before, maybe. So if you're a home brewer, maybe you just know this. Any hops you add at the beginning of your boil are for bitterness in the beer. Any hops you add in the middle are more for flavor. Any hops you add at the end are for the aroma, the smell of the hops. Because those aromatic oils get boiled off very quickly, so you want to add them towards the end. And so you see beers that are called single hop beers. We do quite a few of them. That means we're using the same hop for every point in the boil. We're adding it. And we're really trying to showcase all the aspects of that one particular hop. Maybe it's really strong, maybe you really like it, maybe we have a lot of it, we're trying to get rid of it. And then there's beers like our West Coast IPA, which I said uses 5 different hops. So we're layering all the different characteristics of those hops to get a whole bit of sort of depth in our beer at the very end. Like crazy back there. Alright, so once we've boiled in all our hops, we're going to send that liquid with all that hot sludge onto the whirlpool right here. This is a perfectly circular vessel. We shoot the wort in and all that hot crud at an angle. And then it has jets that continue to propel that liquid in the whirlpool motion. And that way all the hops collect in the middle. You know, you think about whirlpools, all the solid particles collect in the middle. That way we can extract the wort, clean out the sides, how we separate the liquid from the solids that we don't want anymore. So we're almost ready to take that wort and send it on to one of our fermenters across the room here to add the yeast so it can start eating that sugar. However, we just boiled that wort for like an hour and a half, right? Like 90 minutes. That means it's very hot. And yeast as a living organism, like your eye, cannot survive boiling high temperatures. This is a little yeast cell right here. Saccharomyces cerevisiae. They don't actually have eyes, but they still look really cute and hungry, which is what we want. They are sister cells, so I call this our little Miss Yeast right here. So if you add her into the wort too hot, she dies. It's no fun out here. But if you cool that wort down, then you can add the yeast in there. So what we do, they'll survive, they'll do really well. So we have this little heat exchanger underneath the whirlpool, which is just like a little blue and silver radiator. And what we do is we take cold water from our cold water tank. It runs through across the hop. particular type of beer, like West Coast. We'll do 5 runs for all the West Coast hops and malts before we send it on. It takes about 8 hours to fill up one of those tanks. Do 5 runs. Because we have a separate mash, a separate lager, and 2 boiler kettles. This machine right here that's like the bane of my course is what's called a CIP machine, a clean in place. So each three of those tanks in there has a different cleaning chemical, caustic, acid, base. And so all these pipes are connected to all the different tanks in the brewery. And so it's an automatic cleaning system. So once we've made a beer in one of those fermenters and we send it onto those filters, we're going to use that tank for our next batch, right? We need to clean it out because it's a different style or whatever. So this is, we'll send the correct cleaning solution to cleaning stuff. That way someone doesn't manually have to climb inside and scrub it down. That seems crazy. And the reason it does that, sometimes there's a timer system in our brew house. So if our brewers have something they need to do, it'll let them know. That way they can try to work while they're brewing and get multiple things done. And if it does like little short shots, that's basically just like hot air that it's and then we attach a hose like that with a pump at the end. to the bottom, and that's the comic that sucks being stout, and the comic that we own for whatever reason is called a snuggler. We bought it, they don't really know why, they just ordered it in a box, opened it up, says the snuggler on it. So if a tank has been snuggled, that means they suck being stout. And then we're going to do what's called dry hopping the beer. Dry hopping is a technique that basically is adding more hops after fermentation, and that's what's going to give it even more of an aroma, really strong aromatic. All right, we got Steve for our next speaker. You guys really
think they're
Steve?
I love you, man.
Really excited for you.
You're the man.
This is a Belgian double IPA. Oh. Anyone eat Steve right now? If he walked off the floor, we only have like 10 more minutes. Awesome. Doesn't seem like it.
He sent me the chip.
This is one of our best league reputation beers. We won a lot of awards for it. When we created this beer, there were no other double IPAs on the market. We were, as far as we know, the first brewery to create one. And so we've done really well with this too. It's unique in terms of the IPA hop. The Belgian flavor is what you get from the yeast that we use. Particular strain of yeast is cloned after yeast from Belgium. The Belgian yeast strain are known for imparting three very specific flavors into the beer. When you smell it and taste it, the first flavor you might pick up on quite a bit is banana. A big banana, and then clove is more the spice note of the beer. So banana, clove, and the last one that I get when I smell this beer is bubblegum. Really crazy bubblegum. That comes from the East. Yeah.
You're just saying double and imperial?
Yeah, double and imperial are interchangeable terms. They just mean the beer is 8% or higher. It has nothing to do with the alcohol. Doesn't mean it's hoppier than anything else. It has something to do with alcohol, though. We have a double stout. All the hops we need, depending on what tier it is, we load these boxes of hops into the elevator. Takes the elevator, sends all those hops up to the... It's definitely broken.
Good!
Yeah, I was gonna say, I don't
know. Is that working or something? Usually it'll go all the way up to the catwalk, and then when the hops are up there, the brewers will dump them into the fermentation thing. The hops will circulate in the beer for like 2 or 3 more days, and then we send them onto those 2 filters we saw at the beginning, right? The centrifuge and the heat filter, onto the bright tank for more CO2, and then onto the oxygen. These big tanks, if you're trying to get an idea of like why we have to make hops in here, we find a little cooler for them and more in our big cool box. These big tanks, it's 200 to 600 pounds of hop pellet, depending on what beer it is. So quite a bit. Any questions about any of that?
Watch out, there's a little bit of a lip. I'm always afraid someone's gonna like roll an ankle. So, this bottling line we got about 2 years ago, we had it custom made for us, that's why it fits the space so well. We wanted something custom built, that way we can exactly replicate this for our Virginia Beach facility when it opens. It'll be the exact same bottling line, we'll know how it works, how to calibrate it, you know, how to fix it, train people on it. We'll just know everything about it, which will be really helpful. So this bottling line usually has about 4 to 6 guys supervising it, but in terms of actual manually, but there's not a lot involved, it's pretty automated. So on a day that we're bottling, and that's usually like Monday through Friday, pretty early in the morning to like early afternoon, we try not to do it when the tasting room's open, it's very loud. Also, huge equipment, people drinking, only thing separating it is like what, like a 3-foot wall, and then double doors that are the same employee only, yeah. That's what works. For a long time they even say employee only, so they definitely don't want it. So the bottling line, we'll have a whole row of all these pallets behind you guys. So these pallets come pre-cased. They all have empty glass bottles in them, unlabeled Green Flash or Alpine bottles. They're pre-sanitized and they get put into these cases. The bottles come from Ohio, manufactured there. They get palletized like this in South LA and then shipped down here. And someone, basically we take them apart for the most part, someone stands at the beginning of those rollers at the end, and when the machine's on, the rollers are moving, and we take each box full of the bottles, and we load it onto the rollers. The rollers then push that box over here. This is the decaser. So once it's four boxes deep, these heads drop down, pull the bottles out, put them on the conveyor belt up top. And the boxes that are empty now, they actually stay down below on the rollers, which you can see loop around, they go left and around. And then down there, the empty boxes will be the bottles in a minute. All the bottles have been put on a conveyor belt right here, and they head to this main station. Watch out, please stop the...
Oh, sorry.
So they come into the KHS filling station. They get flipped upside down, and each bottle gets pumped full of CO2 twice. Make sure there's no oxygen in there. Oxygen is bad for beer. It makes it taste bad pretty quick, just like light. Also, it helps the beer not foam when we're putting, or beer, yeah, the beer not foam when it's getting pumped very quickly into the bottles. So we pump a flow of CO2 twice, and then they get the beer put in, the cap gets put on, and when they come out, there's a single file line that they get sent out in, and there's a laser right at the very end where that little biohazard sign is. That laser measures every bottle for the liquid fill. So if the beer amount is even a hair below the 12 ounces or the 22 ounces that it needs to be, it automatically gets kicked off the line. The machine diverts it to the back. We don't sell low fills for two reasons. It looks bad. If you've ever had a weird low fill, especially from like a smaller brewery where they don't have as much like quality control, it kind of stinks. Also, the more space in the neck of the bottle, the faster air can get in, and they'll get the beer, it'll make it taste back quicker.
It does that single file though?
Yeah.
Wow.
So they come out single file, and then they all get sent through. Well, and by the way, our low fills, we dispose of those. Usually on places like employee patios.
Yeah.
Through those yellow tubes, they're called air blades. They work like the hand dryers in the bathroom. They quickly blow the bottles dry, that way there's no condensation. That's because they're gonna have a label put on. They keep a sticky label to go right on there, that batch
labeler.
Awesome. Well, if you guys have any more questions, we're going to head back to the tasting room to get your last taste.